Dagon is the second story that Lovecraft wrote when he returned to writing fiction seriously in 1917. And here we have a recurring theme, as we found in the tomb in the opening of the story, where pardon me, I need to find my eyes. Where we find, "I am writing this under an appreciable mental strain, since by tonight I shall be no more. Penniless, and at the end of my supply of the drug which alone makes life endurable, I can bear the torture no longer, and shall cast myself from this garret window into the squalid street below. Do not think, from my slavery to morphine, that I am a weakling or a degenerate. When you have read these hastily scrawled pages, you may guess, though never fully realize, why it is that I must have forgetfulness or death." So this is a theme that Lovecraft returns to, of madness born of revelation, dark cosmic revelation. We find this in The Hound, and I'm sure there are others, although I cannot think of them at the moment. Dagon, some have said, was re-visualized in later years when Lovecraft returned from his 2 years of exile in New York and wrote The Call of Cthulhu. Let us see what... This is the Penguin edition. The Call of Cthulhu and Other Weird Stories. I find it interesting that ST included both Dagon and The Call of Cthulhu in the same book. I would have placed them in different volumes, but let us read ST's introduction to Dagon. Dagon was written in the summer of 1917, shortly after the writing of The Tomb. These two stories constituted the first fiction Lovecraft had written since his abandonment of story writing in 1908. The tale was first published in W. Paul Cook's amateur journal, The Vagrant, for November 1919. Its publication in Weird Tales for October 1923 constituted Lovecraft's first appearance in that legendary magazine. I did not remember that that was the case. This was... Dagon was the first story that Lovecraft sold to Weird Tales. I believe he initially sent 5 stories to Weird Tales. He sent them in manuscripts that were single-spaced. And the editor said, "I cannot accept these stories unless they are typed in double space." So the stories were returned, and then Lovecraft typed one of the stories, which I believe was Dagon, and typed it in double space, sent it to Weird Tales, and it was accepted. Okay, continuing with S.T. Joshi's notes. Lovecraft notes that Dagon was at least in part inspired by a dream. John Ravana Bolan, a member of the Transatlantic Circulation, an Anglo-American group of amateur journalists who exchanged and criticized one another's manuscripts, noted, "We are told that the narrator crawled into the stranded boat, which lay grounded some distance away. Could he, half sucked into mire, crawl to his boat?" Lovecraft responded, "The hero victim is half sucked into the mire, yet he does crawl. He pulls himself along in the detestable ooze, tenaciously, though it cling to him. I know, for I dreamed the whole hideous crawl, and can yet feel the ooze sucking me dying." That's from the essay In Defense of Dagon, which was published in 1921. S.T. continues, "There may also be contemporary literary influences on the story. William Fulweiler is probably correct in sensing the general influence of Irvin S. Cobb's Fishhead, a tale of a loathsome, fish-like human being who haunts an isolated lake, and a tale that Lovecraft praised in a letter to the editor when it appeared in the Argosy of January 11, 1913. Although the story's influence on a later work, The Shadow Over Innsmouth, is still more evident." And then S.T. has quite a few annotations for the story. There are many elements here that make this story, early as it is, uniquely Lovecraftian. Part of it is that he found the inspiration for the story in a dream. Lovecraft was a phenomenal dreamer, and many of his stories and many of the story notations that he recorded in his commonplace book are accounts of dreams. Indeed, the prose poem vignette Nyarlathotep was based completely on a dream, and Lovecraft wrote to correspondents that he actually wrote the first paragraph of Nyarlathotep before he was fully awake. This presentation of Dagon here at YouTube is superb. And again, if you've watched the video, then you kind of know the ending. If you have not read the story, I am going to discuss the ending now, so perhaps if you do not appreciate such spoilers, you should not watch the rest of this video. How much time do I have? The ending poses problems. It is quite ludicrous, many of us feel, to think that... I'm going to actually read the ending of the story. It's not quite fully explained in this wonderful video presentation of the story. "It is at night, especially when the moon is gibbous and waning, that I see the thing. I tried morphine, but the drug has given only transient surcease and has drawn me into its clutches as a hopeless slave. So now I am to end it all, having written a full account for the information or the amusement of my fellow men. Often I ask myself if it could not all have been pure phantasm, a mere freak of fever as I lay sun-stricken and raving in the ocean boat after my escape from the German man of war. This I ask myself, but ever does there come before me a hideous, vivid vision in reply. The end is near. I hear a noise at the door of some immense, slippery body lumbering against it. It shall not find me. God, that hand, the window, the window. Now, what exactly is happening there? Are we to believe? Some people have actually proposed this scenario, that the creature seen from the submerged island actually is walking down the streets of San Francisco in pursuit of the narrator of the story. Knows where the person is living and is reaching into the window. God, that hand. It just seems like nonsense to me. And there the narrator asks himself, could this be a phantasm? Is this a dream? So again, as so often in Lovecraft, we are delivered a dilemma. How much of this narrative is reality? How much of it is mere dreaming, illusion, or lunacy? Caitlin Kiernan was a guest last year at the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival, and she gave a wonderful speech, and part of that speech was she showed this delightful dust jacket for an early edition of the Arkham House Dagon. And she pointed out that this is actually a superior and authentic rendition of a portion of the narrative where a giant is harpooning this giant whale. There are many things about Dagon that are intriguing and maddening. The prose style for such an early story is extremely smooth, mature, and effective. I do not find any overwriting, and the story is an imaginative gem, and it shows Lovecraft finding his voice and his vision. And then he went on to write so many more wonderful stories. Dagon is a very good story, and this video presentation of it, I think, is superb. This animated form of dramatizing Lovecraft fiction shown here at YouTube is, I think, a wonderful form, a perfect form for showing Lovecraft's fiction. It's quite good. Alright, running out of time. I need to do some reading. I've been reading. I'm going to run out of time. This is a great book, The Womb of Time by Brian Stableford. I've just read, this has two Lovecraftian novellas. The first is The Womb of Time, which takes place in Dunwich in England, and it concerns Clu-Clu. It is superb. I just finished reading it. I am now reading the second story, which is about Eric Zahn.